Hello, I'm Lalisa Duguma from the World Agroforestry Center, scientist in sustainable landscapes. I'm going to talk about mangrove vegetation dynamics in the Gambia and Ghana. As you can see, we have quite a number of co-authors who contributed to this work. And this work is part of the Women, Shellfishers and Food Security Project supported by the USAID. When we look at the broader narratives around mangrove vegetation dynamics, both in Ghana and the Gambia, two main streams of discussions have dominated the last few decades. The first one is the restoration one, where there is an increment because people are investing in restoring the mangrove vegetation. So many have argued that there is an increment, but at the same time, others have argued that there is a degradation or there is a loss happening due to anthropogenic factors, which are limiting the expansion of this vegetation type or even clearing the vegetation type for other purposes. For us, understanding these dynamics is very critical because there are thousands of households who are directly dependent on the oysters and the shellfishing activities that are originating or that are dependent on this vegetation type in coastal ecosystems. And also there are hundreds of thousands of households whose livelihoods are indirectly affected by this vegetation dynamics that is happening in and around coastal areas, particularly through the change in the mangrove vegetation context. That's why it is really important for us to know the dynamics, which really tells us the prospect or the future opportunities that may arise with these dynamics when it comes to the livelihoods, the coastal resilience, and also the overall sustainability of this ecosystem. The two countries, Ghana and the Gambia, are here. The objective of this study was to explore the mangrove vegetation dynamics in the two countries and provide an overview of the overarching drivers and threats. For the methods, we applied the remote sensing techniques, mainly relying on Landsat imagery and mostly also from MODIS. But most of these collections embedded into the Google Earth Engine cloud computing platform to give us a good perspective of a high resolution imagery that could help us to make the inferences or the interpretations of what is currently on the land and what used to be there before. The good part of the process that we deployed is that we managed to gain an accuracy of over 93% in most of the classification processes that we conducted. Of course, the cloud cover challenge in Ghana is something that we always emphasize. Looking at the results, especially in Ghana, there was a significant decline from 2000 to 2010. And then there is a sudden pickup after 2010 because people realized we are losing a very important vegetation type. And so many people began and institutions began to invest in this restoration activity. That's what led to this improvement since 2010. In the Gambia, of course, all the time there was a positive trend, even though the magnitude of change was quite small. These are net changes. What you see on these graphs are net area changes. When I say net, in every context, there is a loss happening at every point in time, and there is also a gain happening. So the net is always between those two lines of discussions, the gain and the loss. In this context, for example, if we take the Gambia, it gained about 120 square kilometers over 20 years period. This came because of the various restoration activities by governments, technical partners or donors and communities taking action to restore this vegetation type. But at the same time, the loss was also significant because our analysis shows the country lost about 42 square kilometers. This loss is what is very critical for us in this context, because this loss is not the small mangrove. This is a mature mangrove which is cleared for different purposes. In Ghana, it's also the same story, but a different version. The country lost most of its mangroves in the last 20 years compared to what it has gained. And the net gain or the net loss actually is about 540 square kilometers. This is quite important because in Ghana, the livelihoods and the lives and livelihoods depending on these coastal ecosystems are quite huge compared to what you have in the Gambia. What is driving all of these changes is, one, it is about the population. Here you can actually see the dense estuary in 2009, 2015, and 2018. What you see here is how human settlement has expanded over time, taking majority or the major part of the dense estuary, which is creating a pressure on the ecosystem. So as I said before, population dynamics plays a major role, because with population increment, there is always the demand. With demand, there is extraction. That extraction is now what creates pressure on the ecosystem overall. There is land clearing for farming and residential spaces, as we have seen in Densu. It's also happening in the Gambia, in Karawan area, for example. Pollution associated with population increment is a major element. And infrastructure arising from the demand by the population is another factor, because they have to create a space for the infrastructure to be constructed. With this population, there is also this economic activity oriented threats that really are pushing the mangroves to the limits, because there is extraction and utilization that is happening. And in particular, there are these practices which are happening both in Gambia, in the Gambia and Ghana, from oyster collection and steaming of fish or smoking of fish, which is quite a rampant practice that we have observed on the ground. Overall, what is important here is understanding how such drivers and threats evolve over time and how they affect the mangrove ecosystem, directly or indirectly, is crucial to design proper response options. The future of the thousands of women households or women shellfishers depending on this ecosystem actually relies on what kind of response options we put in place. So it's not just about the current issue, it is about also the implications of the changes, the dynamics that we are observing. So with this, I would like to say thank you, and we really appreciate the communities who participated in various discussions that led to this work, and also the various entities who supported this work. Thank you.